We now have Yannis, so he will give us an experience from the farming. A young farmer, he is actually the president of the European Council of Young Farmers, Sergio. So he is really very well placed to discuss how European farmers and the expectations of young European farmers are at the very moment of the discussions around the CAP. And the title is Connecting Farmers to Markets in Africa. So, Yannis, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Chair, and thanks a lot for inviting us also as young farmers to take part in this discussion. Well, you've already presented us a little bit, but maybe who are we? We're the European Council of Young Farmers, this year celebrating our 60th anniversary already, so quite an established organization which brings together the young farmers from across Europe in their own national young farmer organizations, so now membership spanning across 24 different European countries. Maybe let me start by saying that a lot of the things that I've put in my PowerPoint of that I was thinking of were already touched about by the presentation of DG Agri by the Commission, which maybe shows one of the most important issues when it comes to these discussions, because I would say we've done a good job as farmer organizations, as representatives, to tell our European government what are the challenges we are facing, and they have a very good job listening to those challenges. And so maybe that is the biggest message of them all: make sure that farmers have structures, make sure that farmers have those direct lines with policymakers in order to really get their challenges across on a very direct level. And I think that is what will also take some time. As I said, we're already working on it for a few decades, and sometimes we're still frustrated that this doesn't work as we would like to, but it gives a lot of strength in the discussion that we have. Quickly about me, I'm a young dairy farmer from here, from Belgium, so very local. That's our farm from an eye point view. This is in autumn, in winter, it looks very white. On holidays, last Christmas, we had a little calf being born, and the reason that I put it in there, because, of course, it's very nice to show always when a newborn arrives on the farm. But maybe more importantly, that we all have to realize that farmers, wherever in the world, whatever the scale, whatever the production they have, very often work on a yearly basis constantly. There is no such a thing as quitting the farm at any given point. And of course, we have to work towards having the social capacity to maybe create the opportunity on going on holidays and so on, but the farm will always continue to work. And also, that gives away a need to whatever solution comes forward. You have to understand the sort of fear of adaption that farmers might have, because we are not starting from a vacuum. We are starting from today's reality, and very often getting into something new, whatever innovation it is also taking a risk, because that work on the farm still needs to be done. We have to keep that in mind when talking about these issues. When it comes to innovation, and then the question was a bit to focus on digitalization, let me first say that, of course, innovation has a lot of areas of entry, whether it is digitalization like we are discussing now, or innovation in plant breeding, in new markets, whatever kind of innovation we have. It takes three main principles into account, and some of the speakers already pointed out. Research and development, those are essential and very, very often are at the core of the debate, but implementation is as important. Any innovation is useless if at the end it isn't implemented, in this case on a farm level. And for that implementation, I would define two major areas of importance. First of all, the framework, and the framework when we talk about the access to broadband for digitalization, the access of knowledge, how to uptake the digital knowledge about how system works, but also how you translate the information that you get into a farm practice. And then as a second one, also the tools. And the tools are tools for investment, access to information, making sure that's the research and development, that the innovation doesn't keep stick on a higher level, let's say. In that area, maybe something which is also important for African development, when we talk about the framework, is still the need for hard infrastructure. It is useless to know with market information which is available to know that that it might be best to keep my produce a few weeks or months longer because price levels are expected to rise in that time frame. If I'm not able to store anything at all, then that information again becomes useless. So those hard infrastructures are also still an essential part of innovation. Three main areas of innovation and digital innovation: the technical improvements. That's the inside of a tractor, GPS, seeding equipment, and so on. I think that is an area that we are all already considering, and that is very very much at the core of the debate, rightfully so. And again, that this doesn't matter whether it is a large-scaled or a small-scaled farm. Any kind of farmer can, in the right way of uptake, use these kind of improvements. A second one, as important, market information, getting information out there, and that it's essential for me as a young farmer in Europe to know what not only my prices on a daily level, but also what are the prices or the evolutions in prices of the commodities that are being processed, starting from my primary product. For me, it's important to have an idea on what the constant euro-dollar exchange rate is in order to know what the effect might be, what the price of oil is, in which I'm not directly selling nor buying. However, we know that it has a certain impact on the value of our products. So all these information needs to be out there, needs to be open source, available for farmers. But again, we also need to increase our knowledge level, all generations, by the way, increase our knowledge level on how to use that information in our farming practice. And some information will be more vulnerable for some farmers and other less for others. Maybe also, when it comes to market information, important to state that whether you are active on a global market or on a very local market, the information stays as important. Those markets are interconnected. It's not because you sell to the village next door that the global market isn't affecting your own price levels and so on. Also for what we call smallholder farmers, even though I'm a bit skeptical about that term, not because of the small, because again, scale doesn't matter for us. And you have very professional farms, large and small scale, but because of the word holder, because I don't believe that a lot of people choose to just hold a farm. No, people want to thrive in their farm, want to be active in an economical way on their farm. There are some communities who have farming as a lifestyle, and there we need to place a social policy in order to embrace that those communities. But the vast majority of farmers is willing to be an entrepreneur, whatever scale, and we have to consider them as such. A third major point when it comes to digitalization and the value it has to farmers is connection to the world. And here we have to really consider that if we want to maintain having young people in rural areas, having young people farming, that we also have to provide to them a decent way of life. And that's a decent way of life in having the opportunities to connect with social occasions, with internet. But that's also politically making sure that they keep on having a voice and that they are also considered a valuable partner in any debate. And since globally we are seeing that the longer people are living in urbanized areas, that doesn't mean that future minorities on rural areas shouldn't be considered in the political debate and in the choices for investment by governments. Maybe I've jumped over it a bit too fast. I'll go back to the market part, because it has been touched upon by the presentation of the Commission. As organization, together with Copacogeca, we have invested a lot of time in creating what we call an EU code of conduct for data sharing, because data protection is quite essential when it comes to gathering information, not only because of the principle of it, but also if we want to convince farmers that the use of data and open source is a good thing, we have to make sure that they can trust whatever is happening with their information. And therefore, what we as an industry, because it was farmers together with partners in the chain, have done is come up with a code of conduct, not as much pointing out what should happen with data, but pointing out what should be included in any agreement, in any transaction of data. What are the major principles to take on board, whether it comes to data ownership, as we said, or further use or processing of data, and so on. And it is very important that as a farming industry, let's say, we keep on trusting in whatever happens with information we are sharing. I think I'm running to the end. I don't know how much time I have. Lovely. Well, why would young people still farm? Because I always like to end up with a positive note. And maybe also a warning in the discussion that when it comes to attracting the new generation, I was very happy that in the beginning it was said we don't have to push young people into farming. Absolutely not. We have to attract them. And today we hear a lot about making agricultural sexy again. Well, there are certainly some parts which are very attractive to me. A lovely place to grow a family. It is a lovely place in open nature. Very attractive symbols. However, we see already today that there is still a lot of people, and I have a picture of some of them across the globe, who are still very interested in farming and who are still very attractive to the profession as such, but who are also facing enormous challenges and barriers into entering. And so making it attractive for sure, but as long as we are not able to solve the challenges and barriers that young people who are already attracted to the industry are facing, then attracting a bigger audience won't necessarily help. We have to make sure that those who are attracted are also be able to choose for a viable future. Maybe one last point: the picture on the left with the two persons on the left-hand side. That's Dennis Kabito, who is a young farmer from Uganda, who is chairing our global young farmer alliance. Let's say where we meet approximately three times a year with young farmers from Europe, from Africa, from Latin America, from Asia, and so on. And on the right-hand side, that's Sarah Crawford, a young farmer from New Zealand. Those two are representing us now. So that's it, I think. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much, Yanis, for the enthusiasm which you projected about the positiveness that Seja and the opportunities and the work that you are conducting at the European level. And maybe, why not giving your links with the global networks and with the African networks, share these experiences and maybe have opportunities to scale them up in terms of exchanging of best practices.